Dear Agni Yogis, education or self-improvement is one of the key topics of Agni Yoga. To grow, to become a great soul, is precisely the meaning of our life. The aim of Agni Yoga is to create the next stage of evolution, the new man. Thus, we are embarking on a gigantic project. We want to grow a new superior race by spiritual means. Are you a racist?
No, of course not. A racist is someone who pretends to be superior to others just because he belongs to a certain people. In the sense in which it is used here, race means a theosophical technical term denoting the next higher step of evolution. Its superiority is based on real, eternal, inner values that are independent of the color of skin, hair, or eyes. Nietzsche's Overman becomes a reality. On the ladder of evolution, it is just as much above today's human beings as we are above the monkeys.
You can acquire these higher qualities of the soul just as well as those of the body.
Unlike the animals, we humans must actively take part in the progress of our own evolution. The coming immortal man of spirit will not be born. He will not appear unless we ourselves create him. Agni Yoga, and thus our school, offers an education plan, a complete program for your development from a small to a great soul. The Mahatmas of the Brotherhood of Shambhala have already climbed this step. We only have to follow them and walk the same path which they have gone ahead of us and which they have paved for us. We are talking about a scientific concept of education. Just like Helena Blavatsky and others in ashrams of the Brotherhood in Tibet, you too are systematically trained for your mission on Earth. Although with us, of course, starting at a lower level.
The highest yogis were in contact with the supermundane world and knew what scientific and spiritual perfection was possible.
The serious education is based on those three sets of exercises we have already discussed and continues what has been achieved there. First, serious experiment immortality, with the exercises transformation into a spiritual being, exercise invulnerability, bring your soul to life, and the fiery state. Second, series the 10 pillars of the practice of Agni Yoga, which presents and rehearses a way of life appropriate to infinity. Third, series the path of the disciple. Without a teacher, there is no progress, a fact that many of you have not yet fully realized. There we are talking about your entry into the spiritual school and the topics finding a teacher, becoming a disciple, living in the continuous presence of the teacher, the path of the inner temple, and living in the ashram of the teacher. If you practice these exercises regularly, you have already made good progress on the path of your education to a great soul. We had already said, man, like a centaur, is a hybrid, namely partly a material and partly a spiritual being. He lives with his feet, the four perishable bodies, on earth, and with his head, the fiery body, the eternal individuality, in heaven, in the world of the soul. The education of Agni Yoga deals with our whole being, with its physical as well as with its non-material aspects. That leads us necessarily to the following education plan. We have to train first our four perishable bodies, the physical body, the body of feelings, the body of instincts, and the body of thoughts, and finally to educate our eternal individuality, the soul. We will go through this program step by step today and in the subsequent broadcastings. What does education mean? Purification, mastery, strengthening, beautification, and refinement. Going to school once more, go through education again, that does not look particularly attractive to me. Well, let us emphasize again, deep within you is hidden an immeasurable potential. Your eternal individuality, your being of spirit, is invested with gigantic, hardly imaginable abilities and powers, which at present still lie almost completely dormant. Education means nothing else than to unearth and use this treasure. Is it not a wonderful project to unfold your being to its true greatness? Let us first clarify three basic terms, which we will encounter again and again in the further course of our broadcastings: spirit, higher self, and lower self. The body is always contrasted with the spirit. This is not really clear to me. Which spirit is meant? Yes, the term spirit is ambiguous, and its various applications lead to much confusion. First, there is the threefold division of the human being into body, soul, and spirit. We had already talked about this in the broadcasting The Law of Evolution. In this context, spirit means the monad, the indestructible grain of spirit within us, the spirit fire, the part of the divine in us, which drives us to refine and spiritualize ourselves ever further. With it, we are not concerned when we are speaking of education. Why not? Because the grain of spirit is immutable and therefore cannot be educated at all. Second, we often speak of the spirit in contrast to the body. This refers to the six non-material, invisible aspects of the human being, which exist in addition to the physical body, namely, the perishable bodies of feelings, of instincts, and of thoughts, also called the subtle body, as well as Atma, Buddhi, and Manas, the eternal individuality, the soul, also called the fiery body. If you forgot about the details, watch again the broadcasting the subtle constitution of man. Thirdly, the term spirit is also used as a synonym for the soul, the eternal individuality. We must clearly distinguish between these three completely different meanings and express ourselves so unambiguously that there can be no doubt as to which of them we are referring to. In the language of Agni Yoga, lower self is a term for the four mortal bodies, or the transient personality, physical body, body of feelings, body of instincts, and body of thoughts. Is the lower self now bad or not? Neither. It only belongs to an earlier stage of evolution. On the descending arc of involution, the grain of spirit first appeared in an ethereal garb and, in the further course of development, formed an ever denser physical body. See the broadcasting the law of evolution. To this body belongs an animal consciousness, such as animals have. It is connected to the physical plane alone and separates itself from other beings. The thoughts, feelings, words, and deeds that arise from the animal consciousness are egotistic and directed towards survival, reproduction, comfort, pleasure, and power over others. These feelings and needs are a natural part of our being that we brought with us from earlier times of evolution. They are not bad, but a legitimate expression of the divine spirit. They were necessary and even progressive at that time, in order to overcome even lower levels, in order to take the step from the plant to the animal kingdom. An animal, in contrast to a plant, can move freely and enters the new world of eating and being eaten. It will be hardly able to survive there without a pronounced instinct for self-preservation. The soul, when it appeared on the material plane billions of years ago in the first race of the first round of the first cycle, was originally ethereal, non-material, and perfectly pure. Through many later incarnations in animal and human bodies, however, it also acquired animal qualities that are, in actual fact, alien to its true spiritual nature. When your soul was incarnated in a lion or a tiger, you had to hunt other animals, such as antelopes or buffaloes, every few days, defeat them in a wild and dangerous struggle, kill and eat them, in order to ensure your own survival and that of your brood. Of course. Something of that still sticks to your bones. And now you have got to get rid of it again. Humanity is saturated with cravings. When the spirit yields to the manifested cravings, the step into evolution is limited by the visible. The opposite striving of the spirit establishes the step of affirmed evolution. For millennia, in all cultures, the churches have put people under pressure and made them feel guilty about their so-called base desires without us really knowing why. Religions began to prohibit something without knowing exactly why. Today, we say better. We must gradually overcome the animal qualities retained within us if we want to reach the superhuman level. They are outdated. They no longer correspond to the latest state of evolution. Urusvati overcomes her inherited atavism. Every yogi understands that he will succeed in throwing off the burden of atavism only by elevating his yogic nature. It is said that the monkey is easily offended. What is that to us? The panther can be very irritable. What is that to us? It is said that the hen clucks without reason. It is said that the vulture endlessly nourishes his ire. What is that to us? A parrot repeats slander. What is that to us? It is said that a duck cannot control its nerves. What is that to us? Let us not emulate them. We see higher and lower self denotes a relative evaluation. What used to be a considerable achievement yesterday will have to be replaced in the course of further progress of evolution by a still higher attribute tomorrow. Each action which rends the spirit from earthly desires is a higher realization. Those were great and proud times when you were the king of the animals. Nietzsche indulged in glorifying them still in our days with expressions like blonde beast or pack of blonde predators. But these supposedly good old days are gone forever. Let us not look back, but forward. The animal in man has no future. That belongs to the king, the priest, the sage, the divine within us. The caterpillar must pass away so that the butterfly can emerge. Both cannot exist at the same time.